welcome to this service from the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Praying together our call for purity. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets."
Lord, have mercy upon us, and write, O thief, thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray our collect for this morning. Almighty God, who has given thine only Son to be unto us both a sacrifice for sin and also an example of godly life, give us grace that we may always most thankfully receive that his inestimable benefit, and also daily endeavor ourselves to follow the blessed steps of his most holy life, through that same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for our first reading.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. For thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out, as shepherds seek out their flocks when they are among the scattered sheep, so will I seek out my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries, and will bring them into their own land, and I will feed them on the mountains of Israel by the watercourses and in all the inhabited parts of the land. I will feed them with good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and they shall feed on rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak. But the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them with justice. As for you, my flock, thus says the Lord God, I shall judge between sheep and sheep, between rams and goats. Is it not enough for you to feed on the good pasture, but you must tread down with your feet the rest of the pasture? When you think of clear water, must you foul the rest with your feet? And must my sheep eat what you have trodden with your feet, and drink what you have found fouled with your feet? Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep. Because you pushed with flank and shoulder and butted all the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide, I will save my flock and they shall no longer be ravaged, and I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant, David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today can be found on the screen, or if you are using the prayer book, on page 367. Oh, rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous.
For he becometh well the just to be thankful.
Praise the Lord with harp.
Sing praises unto him with the harp, lifting with the ten strings.
Sing unto the Lord a new song.
Sing praises lustily with a good courage.
For the word of the Lord is true.
And all his works are faithful.
He loveth righteousness and judgment.
The earth is full of goodness of the Lord.
By the word of the Lord were the heavens made.
And all the host of them by the breath of his mouth.
He gathereth the waters of the sea together, as it were in a bottle.
And layeth out the deep as in a treasure house.
Let all the earth fear the Lord.
Stand in awe of him, all ye that dwell in the world.
For he spake, and it was done.
He commanded, and it stood fast.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
A reading from the first epistle of St. Peter. For it is to your credit if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, where is the credit in that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that, free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
For Jehovah's awful throne.
Lord be with you.
The
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd, and my own, I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Please be seated. We're at a little bit of a disadvantage when we hear this gospel reading this morning, this Good Shepherd Sunday. However familiar and however beloved and however comforting this reading may be, it's one we all know well, probably from Sunday school days and that sort of thing. But we're at a disadvantage because I think it's safe to say that most of us, I'll hazard a guess and say probably all of us here, now live at such a distance from the life of shepherding, and even perhaps of farming or raising animals, that it's an image we have to perhaps rely on our imaginations to fill out. Like you, I've met sheep, but I've never met a shepherd, at least not the wandering the hills with the herd in search of pasture land type shepherd. I don't know really what it takes to be a good shepherd. I'm not even sure I could pick a really good sheep out of a flock if I was forced to. So I imagine that you, like me, must lean on imagination to try and enter into what Jesus is trying to teach us by referring to himself as the good shepherd, an image that would have been familiar and common to people in Jesus' time and throughout most of history. One of the problems is that the Good Shepherd is one of the images of Scripture that, like the Nativity, tends to fall victim to a kind of nauseating sentimentality. I really hope that I don't offend you if you have it on your wall at home, but I am quite sure somewhere on one of the walls of one of the homes within my family, there is that picture of Jesus bathed in a warm, soft, glowing light, looking like he should be on the cover of a Fleetwood Mac album, embracing an impossibly sweet and fluffy white little lamb. If you don't have it yourself, you know the one I'm talking about, or many that are like it, which is to say, if you're thinking of getting me a Christmas gift, don't give me that. Now, on the one hand, of course, I find pictures like that to be a bit like eating a tablespoon of sugar, way too much and way too sweet. But on the other hand, the image has an enduring quality to it. If you go back into the catacombs under Rome to the early centuries of the church, where Christians, I mean, literally in the early decades of the church, when Christians were hiding underground and performing or celebrating the Eucharist, and where they buried their dead. Deep in these catacombs, you'll find that the most common image painted above the tombs is an image of Jesus as a shepherd. And for us, it is a familiar and a comforting image, not because I think of BG Jesus in it, but instead for the way that Jesus holds the lamb. What we see in those depictions is what we long for, what we know ourselves to need, tenderness and love. A former bishop of London, reflecting on the post-Easter Gospels in the prayer book, noted that at one point in his career, a real live shepherd gave him a real live wooden shepherd's crook to use in church. Bishops' croziers, their staves, of course, are modeled on shepherd's crooks. The bishop recounted that he asked the shepherd how the staff was actually used practically in shepherding. That is, how do you actually use the hook to grab the sheep by the neck to pull and to push them? Or how do you use the rounded back to give them a thwack if they need it, or the pointed end to push and to prod them along? To his surprise, the shepherd replied, "I have absolutely no idea. I don't use it for those things at all." The bishop asked, "Well, what do you use it for?" The shepherd told him, "I lean on it when I'm tired." He went on to say that he finds that when he is simply with the sheep, when he stands in their midst, when he's calm, when he's gentle to them, when he speaks to them in loving, soft ways, he's quiet, they will tend to match his demeanor and need no real correction at all. So the staff is for him and not for them. What a beautiful image that is for us of Jesus the shepherd and of his love. The love that we are thinking about all this Easter season after the resurrection. It's not an oppressive love. It's not a forceful love. It's not coercive. It's not cruel in any way. It's not a hard love. But it's familiar and present, like the love of a friend who quietly sits next to our bedside when we're sick. Jesus' words from John 10 today shows us what the shepherd is like by contrasting him with the hired hand, the worker. The shepherd, we learn, loves the sheep because they are the shepherd's. And the sheep love and follow the shepherd because he is their shepherd. By contrast, the hired hand is there contractually. He's getting paid to be there. He's not because he loves the sheep. So when trouble comes, the wolf appears, the hired hand runs away because there's nothing of his own to protect. But the shepherd puts himself between the sheep and the wolf as if they were his own family. The hired hand runs, we learn, because the hired hand doesn't know the sheep. And this, I think, is, in a quiet way, the important, most important part of the gospel today, the strong and subtle reminder that we are known. "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me," says Jesus of himself. Reality is that there is nothing of us that is hidden from him. That's the part that is both comforting, should be comforting, but also should be a little bit terrifying. Because what it means is that there are no secrets that we can hide from God. There are no sins and no shames. There's no betrayals. There's no lies. No thought, no word, no deed of ours that we've ever done, that we are doing, or that we will do, that is unknown to God. We are known better than we know ourselves. And yet, despite this, I know we all probably think, ugh, despite this, we are loved. We are the one out of the 100 that the shepherd goes looking for, leaving the 99 behind when we go astray, which is quite often. We are brought back with love. Sometimes his love can feel like the hook end of a shepherd's crook, but we are nonetheless brought back with love and gentleness. We're brought back with patience, care, whether it's the fifth time we've wandered off or the 55th time. Now, when we talk about the good shepherd, in the original Greek, the word for good that's tacked on to shepherd is the Greek word kalos. That's a word that means what good means for us, good or perfect. We describe a show or a food as good. But in Greek, it has another meaning. And that is that when you put kalos before someone's job title, like shepherd, or like judge, or like soldier, or baker, it comes to mean not only good, but model. As in, not only is the shepherd good, because the shepherd loves and the shepherd cares for the sheep, but the shepherd is in fact the model shepherd. This is the shepherd we should try to emulate and to be like. This shepherd is our role model. The shepherd cares for us, of course, but the message of the gospel is that we are also to care for one another with the love of the shepherd. If this shepherd is the good shepherd, the model shepherd, then we are to emulate the shepherd's goodness and patience and tenderness and forbearance with others in our life, indeed often with ourselves. If he's to seek us out when we are lost, we can't rightly then turn our backs on those of our fellows who go astray. Jesus tells us he is the good shepherd not just to encourage and to comfort us, but to call us in our own lives to remember our duties to live what he has shown us and what he lived and died for us. That's why we pray in that collect that we began the service with today. Really, it's what we're praying for all together today. Almighty God, who has given us thy only Son, Jesus Christ, to be a sacrifice for sin and an example of godly life, it begins, praying that we may always follow in the footsteps of our good shepherd. But not just following his footsteps from behind as he leads us and defends us, but looking to that shepherd calmly leaning upon his wooden staff, or perhaps hanging upon his wooden cross in the midst of the sheep, looking to him as the example on how to live and how to love. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." Amen.
Let us stand now and recite the articles of our belief as found in the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, through whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for a quick moment.
How are we today? be a lamb? Maybe not on a farm, but especially if you're a shepherd in the wild. What do you think happens? What's the big danger for little lambs? They could run away, they could get lost, what else? If that's right, animals, other things might hunt them, because they're not. What do the little lambs, are they like, think of an animal, are they like an animal that they're not born with big sharp teeth? Lambs don't have talons, claws to defend themselves. They're pretty innocent, aren't they? Right? And so the sheep, the mum sheep, the dad sheep, they protect them. Sometimes they need a shepherd. That's what shepherds do. They walk with the sheep in the field to protect them. Sometimes they need dogs to help protect them. But what do you think? Are we more like sheep or are we more like lambs? Why? Why do you think, Dylan? Why are you more like a lamb than a sheep? You don't know. Maybe it's because, do you think sometimes we get lost, kind of, so to speak? Sometimes we get lost and wander off. Do we ever get into trouble sometimes? Not like we're bad, but just sort of like we get into danger? We need help? You ever had to ask someone for help? I've had to ask people for help in my life, yeah. And so one of the things is you hear what Jesus said today about himself, and the story we heard Jesus talks about himself. He says, there's not just a shepherd, but the good shepherd. He says, I am the good shepherd. Now what do you think a good shepherd is? What do you think, Alice? What does a good shepherd do? No? Julie, anything? What does a good shepherd do? I think a good shepherd watches out for the animals, for the lambs and the sheep, right? What if they see a wolf? Well, they go and fight the wolf. They stand between the sheep and the wolf, and they use their staff to maybe fight the wolf back. Or do you think if a sheep gets its horn stuck in a fence, do you think the shepherd goes to help them? Well, I think so, probably, yeah. Make sure they have what they need, food and water. They stay up all night. They stay out in the cold and the rain. So Jesus says, I'm like a good shepherd because I take care of you like that, right? We're all kind of like sheep. We're like lambs, and we especially need help. Jesus says, take care of you. I'll be there to watch over you. But he also says something I said in my sermon there that's important, is that he says that we're kind of supposed to be like him. So we're supposed to be like shepherds to other people. So that means that we can help other people when they need it. We can, help them when they're in danger or give them the things that they need if we can. And so what should we pray for today?
That people get help.
Ooh, that people get help. I like it, yeah. Pray that people get help that they need. Anything else? Puts a lot of weight on our shoulders, sort of thing. Pray for that. Let's do it. Loving God, we thank you for today, and thank you for bringing us here to church, and to give us this story of you reminding us and teaching us that you are a good shepherd. You're like a good shepherd who loves us and walks with us and takes care of us. And we pray for all of those people in the world who need that but don't know it yet, that don't know that you walk with them and love them and care for them. And we ask you to just be with them and give them the comfort of knowing that you love them and are with them, and help us to love those people, and help us to love all people, and to offer help when we can, and to just be like you as our good shepherd, and to trust in you when you lead us. And these things we ask in Jesus' name.
Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Thank you. And together, blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, forever and ever. All that is in the heaven and the earth is thine. All things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee.
Let us pray. Dear God, thank you. Thank you for this past week. Thank you for the times that we haven't even realized you helping us. And thank you very much for the times that we do. We ask you, please, that you put in our hearts the ability to be your hands and your feet here on earth as we follow out Jesus' teachings in helping one another. Let us pray for Christ's Holy Catholic Church. Let us pray for peace on earth and for the unity of all Christian people. Let us pray for our missionaries at home and abroad. Let us remember before God those of our brethren who have departed this life and are at rest. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church, militant here in earth. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle Paul taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
We beseech thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. Grant that all our unhappy divisions may be healed, and that all who confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
We beseech thee also to lead all the nations suffering in wars, in famines, natural disasters. We cannot remember to name them all. And we ask you that we lead all nations in the way of righteousness, to guide and direct their governors and rulers, that thy people may enjoy the blessings of health and safety, freedom and peace. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
Grant unto thy servant Charles our King, and to all that are put in authority under him, in our country, our province, in this city, and communities, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to our Primate Linda, our Bishop Sandra, our Rector Colin, and our Priest Ned, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and living word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
Prosper, we pray thee, this our parish, our diocese, and all those who proclaim the gospel of thy kingdom in this diocese and among the nations. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
To all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
We most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those, now not necessarily written on a list, but also those who have asked us to pray for them, for those who are in our hearts, remembering especially Matthew B., Lawrence, Douglas, Matt Rogers, Ren Lucy, Alistair, Sarah, Destiny, Charles, Dr. Harold, Diane, Suman, Melissa M., Corinne, Dorothy, Jerry D., Max, Lori, Isabel, Alfred, Mike H., the Mohammedis, Kilby, Cecil, Donna, Patricia, Jackie, Ben, Alex Q., Graham O., Tatiana, Aaron, Linda, Bob F., Ivan, Trista, Tom, Jeremy, Nadine, Julie W., Franz, Logan, Ron, the Edwards, oh dear, I have forgotten to pronounce her name properly, I shall try. I believe it is Francine, Jagmeet Deep, Ivan, Trista, Tom, Jeremy, Nadine, Julie W., Franz, Logan, Ron, Lee Edwards, and all those who are in our hearts and are close to us. We pray also for any other adversity for whom our prayers are desired. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
We remember before thee, O Lord, all thy servants who have departed this life and faith and fear, and especially also for their families as they go through the grieving process, and for those who have left their mortal remains behind, rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
May your light perpetual shine upon them.
We bless thy holy name for Saint Mary and Saint John, and all who in life and death have glorified thee, beseeching thee to give us grace, that, rejoicing in their fellowship, we may follow their good examples, and with them be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. O Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our cry come unto thee.
Grant this, O Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate, to whom, with thee and the Holy Ghost, be all honor and glory, world without end.
Amen.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead the new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees.
Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all, we acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these and misdoings. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Hear also what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying and worthy of all to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And hear also what St. John saith. If anyone sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God, Creator and Preserver of all things. But chiefly are we bound to praise thee for the glorious resurrection of thy Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the very Paschal Lamb which was offered for us and has taken away the sin of the world, who by his death has destroyed death and by his rising to life again has restored us to everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 O Lord of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord most high. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessing and glory and thanksgiving be unto thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole people, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memorial of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these, thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this, as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, we, thy humble servants, with all thy holy church, remembering the precious death of thy beloved Son, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again in glory, to make before thee in this sacrament of the holy bread of eternal life and the cup of everlasting salvation, the memorial which he hath commanded. And we entirely desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all of the benefits of his passion. And we pray that by the power of thy Holy Spirit, all we who are partakers of this Holy Communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee that thou dost graciously feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, assuring us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are living members of his mystical body, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee. And although we are unworthy, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Glory be to God on high, and in earth peace, goodwill towards all. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee. We give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, on the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten, Jesus Christ. O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high, and glory of God the Father. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, fill your hearts and minds with the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, be with each of you and those you love on this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for a quick moment.
Good morning, everyone. Very happy second Sunday after Easter. Just a few, very few announcements, actually. The first thing I'll highlight, well, first thing is there is coffee over in the hall, so I'll welcome you to join us over there for some fellowship and food. The next thing is around your bulletin, there was something called a survey for congregational members. This comes to us from the DCS, the Diocesan Church Society. I don't want to give a long history, but essentially DCS is our regional council of Anglican churches here on PEI. That sort of every region of our diocese has a council that meets of all the churches in a region. And for complicated historical reasons, ours is just called the Diocesan Church Society and has a kind of a different different history. But at any rate, it is the association or the society of all the churches on the island, and they've been making great stride lately to really change what they offer and how they offer it, how they offer support to parishes across the island, and the kinds of events and workshops and things that they are able to offer. And so this is a very brief survey that came to us. Janet Veith Forbes, who's on the executive, brought it,
and has asked you to fill it out. And I'm not going to lock the door to have you do it, and then you're not allowed out until you finish it. But if you could do it today, that would be phenomenal, here or in the hall. But if you have a moment, and just note that in each one, it says to please rank from one, the most, to five, I assume the least, the themes which interest you the most. And so you can see that there are in each section, well, in the first two sections, it offers that. And really what they're asking is the kinds of things that you, as people in the pews, in a church, would like to see perhaps offered regionally. So, you know, you can see, for example, that, you know, there's specific programs that perhaps you would be really interested as someone on council to see more workshops on church administration, or maybe workshops on music ministry, or whatever. So if you could take a moment and do that, if you haven't already, I hope you haven't already, but if you can, that would be grand. And if not, if over in the hall you'd like to do it and leave it, it'd be very, very much appreciated. Besides that, I would just point you to the bulletin. I'm not going to announce anything. There's a number of things in there. Most pressing, I will announce it, I guess, is that the Men of the Harvest concert is next Sunday afternoon. And I asked this morning, I'll ask again, do we know if we're sold out yet? I asked Ruth, and Ruth said, we don't know. We might be. So anyway, that's just to say ticket sales have gone really well. Contact the office or some of the fundraising committee if you'd like to get one and check in on it. But it has gone very well, and hope to see folks there next Sunday. And a few other announcements there just about other fundraisers and things going on. And just encourage you to take it home and read it. We look forward to seeing you in the hall. Final hymn for today, The Head That Once Was Crowned, hymn 108.
Let us go forth in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah. Amen.